बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम, कैसे हैं आप? दिस इज़ लेक्चर नंबर 9, लेट्स स्टार्ट। सो फर्स्ट वी टेक रिव्यू ऑफ प्रीवियस लेक्चर। इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड मेजर्स ऑफ सेंट्रल टेंडेंसी एंड वी डिस्कस्ड हाउ टू फाइंड वेटेड मीन और विच इज़ आल्सो कॉल्ड वेटेड अर्थमेटिक मीन एंड द कम्बाइंड अर्थमेटिक मीन और कम्बाइंड मीन। दिस इज़ आल्सो कॉल्ड एन ओवरऑल mean. Then we discussed merits and demerits of arithmetic mean, and we discussed different situations in which people use arithmetic mean as a measure of central tendency to deceive other people. And we discussed several cases of this, and then we discussed another measure of central tendency, which is median, and we discussed what are the methods for calculating median for the ungrouped data. So let us discuss the objectives of today's lecture. In today's lecture, we are going to discuss the measures of central tendency, the median, and we will discuss the methods of finding median for the grouped data, and we will also discuss some of the merits and demerits of using median as a measure of central tendency. Then we will discuss another measure of central tendency, which is mode. And we will discuss methods of calculating mode for the grouped data as well as for the ungrouped data. And then we will also discuss some of the merits and demerits of using mode as a measure of central tendency. We will also discuss another measure of central tendency, which is geometric mean. We will discuss methods for calculating geometric mean for the grouped data as well as for the ungrouped data, and we will also discuss some of the merits and demerits of geometric mean. So let's start. So in last lecture we discussed the median as a measure of central tendency. Remember that median is the middle value which divides the data equally into two parts, and remember that the data should be arranged in ascending or descending order. Usually the data is arranged in ascending order. So just arrange the data, and then the middle value of this arranged data, it is called the median. Median is also called the positional average, and remember that arithmetic mean is called the mathematical average. So for ungrouped data, if we have, suppose we have five numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and these numbers are already in arranged form. So the median is the middle value. So in this case, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 3 is the median. So before 3, we have two numbers, and after 3, we have the rest of the two numbers. So 3 is the middle point or the median value. Now suppose we have six numbers. So it means we have now, consider an example of even number of digits. So suppose our data contains six numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then the median is the average of the middle two numbers. That is the number 3 and 4. So if we take the average of number 3 and number 4, so 3 plus 4 divided by 2, so 3 plus 4, 7 divided by 2, we get 3.5. So note that 3.5 exactly lies in the middle of number 3 and 4. So before 3.5 we have three numbers, 1, 2, and 3, and after 3.5 we have the rest of the three numbers, that is 4, 5, and 6. So median is the middle point. So this is all about calculating median for the ungrouped data, and in last lecture we discussed an alternative, more efficient way for finding median for the ungrouped data. But as far as this lecture is concerned, we are going to discuss median for the grouped data. So the formula for calculating median in case of grouped data is median is equal to L plus H over F into N by 2 minus C. So this looks like a complicated formula, but let us discuss each of its components. So once we have the definitions of L, H, F, N, and C, then this will become very easy. So Here, in this case, L is called the lower class boundary of the median class, and H is the width of the class, and this F is the frequency of the median class. This N is equal to summation F, or summation F is called the total frequency, and this C is the cumulative frequency preceding the median class. So from these explanations, we can see that first we have to calculate, we have to find the median class. So once we have the median class in our hand, we can find the lower class boundary, and that lower class boundary will be the denoted by small l. And then the frequency of median class will be f, and then the cumulative frequency preceding the median class, that will be C, and H is the width of class interval. So let us explain this idea with the help of an example. So calculate median for the distribution of examination marks provided below. So in the first column we have marks of different students, and in second column we have the number of students, which is also called the class frequency. So first class is it starts from 30 and goes up to 39. So lower limit of first class is 30, the upper limit is 39. So 30 to 39 is the range of the first class, and there are total of 8 students. And in next class we have 40 to 49, there are 87 students. In next class 50 to 59, 190 students, and so on. In the last class, which is 90 to 99, there are 20 students. So this is a frequency distribution of examination marks of certain students. So our job is to calculate median. Note that this is a grouped data, because data is grouped into different classes. So now the formula for finding median for the grouped data is median is equal to L plus H over F, N by 2 minus C. So from this we can see that L is called the lower class boundary of the median class. So it means we have to construct first class boundaries in order to calculate L, and then after calculating class boundaries, we will calculate the cumulative frequencies to find the value of C, and then we will detect the median class, and then we can find the corresponding numbers. So let us do all these calculations step wise. So in first step, calculate class boundaries. So here I have introduced a new column, which is class boundaries. So remember that in order to calculate class boundaries, we have to take the difference of the two consecutive classes, the lower limit of the second class, and take the upper limit of first class, and subtract this upper limit of first class from the lower limit of second class. That is, subtract 39 from 40. So 40 minus 39, you get 1. Divide this difference by 2, so you get 0.5. so 0.5 is the resultant number. So subtract 0.5 from each of the lower class limits in order to get lower class boundaries, and add the resultant number, that is 0.5, to each of the upper class limits to get upper class boundaries. So here, if we subtract 0.5 from 30, we get 29.5, and if we add 0.5 to the upper class limit, that is 39, so it will be 39.5. So similarly, we can construct class boundaries for the rest of the classes. So next is 40 minus 0.5, 39.5, and 49 plus 0.5, 49.5, and so on. Last one is 90 minus 0.5, which is 89.5. And 99 plus 0.5, we get 99.5. So this is our first step that calculate class boundaries. In the next step, calculate cumulative frequencies. So CF stands for cumulative frequencies. So in order to calculate cumulative frequencies, create a new column at the end of this frequency distribution. So cumulative frequencies, write the first number as it is, and then add this number 8 with the next frequency. So 87 plus 8, we get 95. So it means we are adding together the corresponding frequencies. So this 95 indicates that up to 49 we have 95 students. So up to 49 mean from 30 to 39. So it means it includes both the frequencies of both the classes. So 8 plus 87, 95. Similarly, 190 plus 95, we will get certain number. So that will be the cumulative frequency corresponding to third class. So 95 plus 190, it is 285. So it means from 30 to 59 Mars, there are 285 students who obtained Mars within this range from 30 to 59. Similarly, from 30 to 69, we have to add 304 to 285. So keep adding, we get at the end 885 plus 20, it is 905. So this is how to construct cumulative frequencies. So once we have the cumulative frequencies in hand, we can proceed in order to calculate this median. So next step is find the median class. So remember that in order to find the median class, median is defined as marks obtained by n, which represents the total number of students. In this case, n is equal to summation f, which is 905, sum of frequencies of all students, sum of frequencies, which represents the total number of all students. So n is 905. So median is marks obtained by n by second student. So n is 905 divided by 2, so it is 452.5th student. So this is the position of the median. So next we have to locate this number, which is 452.5, in the cumulative frequency column. So here you can see that first one is 8, so 452 is larger than 8. So it means the first class cannot cover this number. Similarly, 95, 285, and this one, 589. So we can see that this 452, it occurs, it is being covered in this fourth class, in this range, 589. So it means this class 59.5 to 69.5, this will be considered as our median class. So once we have the median class in hand, we can calculate all these numbers. So next we find L, H, F and C. So note that L is the lower class boundary of the median class. So here in our case, the lower class boundary of the median class is 59.5. So this is our L in this case. And this H is width of class interval. It is calculated by taking the difference of any two consecutive upper class limits or upper class boundaries, or we can take the difference of any two consecutive lower class limits or lower class boundaries. So here upper class boundary of upper class limit of second class is 49 and lower class limit of second class is 39. So just take the difference, 49 minus 39, you get 10. So h is 10. Or you can take the difference of 59 and 49. This is again same 10. Or you can take the difference of any two consecutive lower class limit. So 50 minus 40, you will get 10. Or even you can calculate h by taking the difference of any two consecutive class boundaries, 49.5 and 39.5. So just take the difference. So the difference is of 10 units, or 59.5 and 49.5. So it is 10. So value of h is 10. So L is 59.5, the lower class boundary of the median class. H is the width of class interval. It is also called size. And F is the frequency of the median class. So frequency of the median class is 304. So it means the F is 304. And then C is called the cumulative frequency preceding the median class. So preceding mean before the median class. So this is median class, and before this value we have 285. So it means the cumulative frequency preceding the median class is 285. So once we have all the numbers in hand, we can use these values to calculate the median. So in order to calculate median, so we can see that median is, it is L, which is 59.5. So 59.5 plus 5 plus h over f. So h is 10, our f, which is 304, into n by 2, which is n is 905, sum of frequencies divided by 2, minus c. So c is cumulative frequency of preceding class, which is 285. So just divide 905 by 2 and then divide the resultant, subtract from it 285, and then multiply the number by 10 with 10 and divide by 304, and then add the resultant number to 59.5. So the answer will be 65. So note that this is the distribution of marks of the students in certain examination. So it means the median is 65 marks. So this is how to calculate median for the grouped data. So next we discuss some of the merits of using median as a measure of central tendency. So the first is, it is easy to calculate and easy to understand. So idea of calculating median is very easy, and everyone can understand it quite easily. Second is, median works well in case of symmetric as well as in case of asymmetric or skewed distributions. So if the distribution is symmetric, so median can be used, as well as arithmetic mean can be used. But if the distribution is not symmetric, or it is also called asymmetric distribution, or it is also called skewed distribution. So skewed mean it is not equally separated around the middle value, middle line. So if the distribution is asymmetric, so then arithmetic mean is not a good measure of central tendency. But median will work fine even if the distribution is skewed. So whether the distribution is symmetric or it is skewed, median will work fine. But mean or arithmetic mean, it works well only in case of symmetric distributions. So remember that whenever we have data which is symmetric, then we can use any of these two measures. We can use mean as well as the median. But if the data is not symmetric but in skewed form, so then we should not use arithmetic mean. But what we should do, we should use median as a measure of central tendency. So this is very important point to note. So second the next merit of using median as a measure of central tendency is that it is not affected by extreme values. Remember that extreme values are the values which lie very far from the data, or they are also called outliers. So suppose we have data 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then these 5 observations are all the usual observations. So in this case, since the data is arranged, so middle value is 3, so median is 3. So if we change the last number 5 to 20, so now the data is 1, 2, 3, 4 and 20. So it means now the last number 20 is an extreme value which lies far from the first 4 numbers. So now again arranging the data 1, 2, 3, 4 and instead of 5, now we will have 20. So again, since the data is in arranged form, so again the median is the same number 3. So median is still 3. So it means one extreme value by adding one extreme value, it will not change the median, as opposed to mean, which is usually changed by one single extreme value. So hence we can say that median is not affected by extreme values. So even if our data has some extreme values, we can still use median and it will give us the correct results. So let us discuss the sum of the demerits of using median as a measure of central tendency. So it requires the data to be arranged in some order, which can be time consuming. So while calculating median, the first step is to sort or arrange your data. So if we have very long data set containing thousands of observations, then it is very time consuming to arrange this data. But nowadays we can sort the data via different computer packages. We can even use Microsoft Excel to sort the data very easily. So but previously, when the computers were not available, so sorting the data, very large data, it was very tedious or time consuming job. But currently with the help of computers we can do this quite easily. So this is all about the median. Next we discuss another measure of central tendency, which is mode. So mode is also called positional average, like the median. So let us define the mode. So mode is a value which occurs most frequently in a data. So most frequently mean it occurs most of the time or most often. So actually mode is a French word meaning fashion. So it is adopted for most frequent value. Any whatever is in fashion mean the most frequently used item. So that is why this name mode is allocated to most repeated value in the data, or most occurring value, or most frequent value in a data set. So how to calculate mode? So the mode is the value in a data set which occurs most often or maximum number of times. So let us discuss some of the methods for calculating mode for the ungrouped data. So here in example 1 we have hypothetical data, marks of 5 students in a certain quiz. So 10 student 1 got 10 marks, student 2 got 5, third student got 3 marks, fourth one got 6, and last one, the fifth one, got 10 marks. So we want to calculate mode of this data set. So note that 10 value, it is occurring more than any other numbers. So 5 is occurring one time, 3 is occurring one time, 6 is occurring one time, but the number 10, it is occurring 2 times. So it means the mode will be 2, a mode will be 10. So because 10 is occurring most of the times, so 10 is occurring maximum number of times, or it is the most frequent value. So mode in this case will be 10. Let us consider another example. Suppose we have runs made by a batsman in a cricket match. So runs made by around 7 batsmen in a cricket match. So 5, 2, 3, 6, 2, 11, 7. So we want to calculate mode. So in order to calculate mode, we can see that the number 2, it is occurring most of the time. So it means the mode is 2 in this case. So sometimes there is no mode, or there may be several modes in a data set. So for example, let us consider this data of marks of the students. So in this case, we can see that we have marks of 5 students, 10, 5, 3, 6, and 7. None of the number is repeating, and each of these 5 numbers is occurring only one time. So we can say that our data contains no mode. Sometimes we may have several modes in a data set. So suppose we have marks of students. So here in this case, we can see that 10 is occurring 2 times, and the number 5 is occurring 2 times. So it means 10 is occurring 2 times, and 5 is occurring the same number of times as the number 10 occurs. So both number 10 and number 5, they occur 2 times. So it means there are 2 modes in this data set. So the number 5 and the number 10. So this is how to calculate mode in case of ungrouped data. We can also calculate mode for the qualitative data as well. So mode is mostly used for qualitative data. So suppose here we have data of party affiliation. So this is the bar chart. On x-axis we have different parties, PTI, PMLN, PMLQ, PPP, and on y-axis we have their corresponding frequencies. So from this bar chart, we can see that the maximum frequency is 10, which is of PTI. So this means that mode of this data set is our first category, which is PTI. So this is how to calculate mode for the qualitative data with the help of graphs. So just construct a bar chart and pick the maximum frequency. So now we discuss how to calculate mode for the grouped data. So formula for calculating mode in case of grouped data is, it is mode equals to L plus Fm minus F1 whole divided by Fm minus F1 plus Fm minus F2 and whole multiplied with H. So where L is the lower class boundary of the modal class, Fm is the frequency of the modal class, F1 is the frequency of the class preceding the modal class or before the modal class, and F2 is the frequency of the class following the modal class or after the modal class, and H is the width of class interval, which is also called size of the class. Note that there is an alternative formula which is available in literature for calculating the mode, but the formula which is given above, it provides more accurate results. So that's why we are presenting only this formula. So let us discuss an example of calculating mode for the grouped data. So suppose we have the distribution of examination marks which is provided here, and we are interested in calculating the mode. Remember that this is the same data set which we used to calculate the median previously. So in first column we have marks of the students, and in second column we have the number of students, that is the frequency. So we are interested in calculating mode for this grouped data. So note that we have the formula for the mode. So in order to calculate mode using this formula, we first need L, which is the lower class boundary of the model class. So it means first we need to construct class boundaries, and then from the class boundaries and then from the frequency distribution we need to find out the model class. So once we have the model class, then fm is the frequency of the model class, f1 is the frequency of the class preceding the model class, and f2 is the frequency of the class following the model class, and h is the class width. So let us first find the class boundaries. So first calculate class boundaries. So remember that class boundaries can be calculated by taking the difference of of the lower class limit of second class and the upper class limit of the first class. So 40 minus 39, divide this difference by 2, you get 0.5, subtract 0.5 from each of the lower class limits and add 0.5 to each of the upper class limits. So first one is 29.5 to 39.5, and next is 39.5 to 49.5, and so on. So method of calculating class boundaries is same as we calculated earlier in case of median. So once we have class boundaries, the next is to calculate the model class. So find model class. So that is class with the highest frequency, because the definition of mode is the most frequent or most occurring value. So here in this case we can see that from the frequency column the highest frequency is 304. So it means this class, the class containing this frequency, it is the model class. So here it is. So we have the model class here. This is the model class. So once we have the model class, then we can calculate all these numbers. So next we find L, Fm, F1, F2 and H. So once we have the model class, we can calculate L, which is the lower class boundary of the model class. So in this case 59.5 is the lower class boundary of this model class. So L is 59.5, and then H is the class interval, which can be obtained by taking the difference of any two consecutive upper class limits or any two consecutive lower class limits, or the difference of any two consecutive upper class boundaries or lower class boundaries. So 49 minus 39 we get 10, or 49.5 minus 39.5 we get the 10, which is H. It is also called size of the class. And then FM is the frequency of the model class. So here the frequency is 304, so we will denote it as FM. Then F1 is the frequency of the class preceding the model class. So this is model class. So before this we have 190, which is our F1. And then F2 is the frequency of the class following the model class. So F2 is 211. and h is 10, which is already calculated. So once we have all these numbers, we can use the formula of mode to calculate all the numbers. So just replace L by 59.5, FM 304 minus F1, which is 190, and FM minus F1 304 minus 190 plus FM minus F2, so 304 minus 211 multiplied with H, which is 10. So the result is 65.3. Since this is the distribution of marks of the students in a certain exam, so we will write the unit as well. So 65.3 marks is the mode. So mode is 65.3 marks. So this is how to calculate mode for the grouped data. So now we discuss merits of using mode as a measure of central tendency. So it is easy to calculate and understand, and in many cases it is extremely easy to locate the mode. So if you are provided with any data set, so just look at the data and pick the most repeated or most occurring value. So it is very easy to calculate or locate the mode. Or if you have the data which is represented in a graphical format, then you can pick the mode very easily by looking at the graph. So next merit is it works well even in case of extreme values. So whether your data contains extreme values or outliers, so mode is not affected by these values. So mode is the most frequent values, so it will pick the most occurring values even if your data contains some extreme or outliers. So next merit is it can be determined for qualitative data as well as for quantitative data. So we can use we can calculate mode for both types of data, quantitative as well as qualitative data. Now let us discuss the demerits of using mode as a measure of central tendency. So it is not based on all the observations. Suppose your data contains certain observations and some of them are the most repeated values, then the mode will be that specific repeated value, and it will not take into account the rest of the observations. So this is a big drawback in the mode, that it is not based on all the observations. Second demerit of using mode as a measure of central tendency is that when the data contains small number of observations, then in that case the mode may not exist. So mode may not exist. Suppose we have 5 numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then we can see that all these 5 numbers, they are occurring only once. So it means in this case there is no mode. So next we discuss another measure of central tendency, which is called the geometric mean. So when you want to measure the rate of change of a variable over time, then you need to use geometric mean instead of simply using the arithmetic mean. So how to calculate geometric mean? It is the nth root of the product of n values. So just multiply all n values and find their product, and then take the nth root. Nth root is actually just is same as taking the power of the product as 1 over n. So now we discuss how to calculate geometric mean for the ungrouped data. So general formula for finding geometric mean for ungrouped data is, if for n observations x1, x2 and so on xn, it is the nth root of product of n values. So that is geometric mean is x bar g. G stands for geometric mean. So just find the product of all values, x1 multiplied with x2 multiplied with x3, x4, so on, xn. So just find the product of n values and then take the nth root. When this n is very large, then it is difficult to compute geometric mean using this formula. So then this is simplified by considering an alternative form of the above formula. So suppose you have two numbers, only x1 and x2, or suppose you have two numbers 2 and 4. So just multiply and find the square root. So this will be the geometric mean. So product of two numbers and their nth root. So if we have n values, we need to take the nth root. But if we have two values, we need to take the square root. And if we have another number, suppose 3, then we are interested in finding the geometric mean of these three numbers. In that case, we need to calculate the third root, or this is also called the cube root. So 2 multiply 4 multiply 3 and then take the cube root of this product. So but since this formula is, it involves the product of n numbers, so taking this nth root when the number of observations are very large, it is quite difficult or burdensome. So in order to overcome this difficulty, there is an alternative form of the same above formula. So let us proceed to that one. So here is the main formula. Geometric mean is the product of n numbers x1, x2 and so on xn, and then their nth root. So first step, take logarithm on both sides. You can take simple logarithm or you can take the natural logarithm as well. But anyway, here just take the simple log on both sides. So log of x bar g and log of this right hand side. So I have just taken the log. Rest of the expressions are same. So next we have to simplify this right hand side. So note that the definition of this nth root is that we can write this nth root as 1 over n. So the product as it is, and then instead of this nth root, we can write it in exponent form as 1 over n. So this is the same nth root. So remember that the square root is 1 divided by 2. The cube root is 1 divided by 3. So nth root is 1 divided by n. Now there is a rule of logarithm that if we have a certain number raised to certain power, then this exponent or power, it can be taken at the start. So just shift this 1 by n at the start. So we get 1 over n and then this log of this product. So next we again have another rule that log of product of numbers can be written as sum of log of each numbers. So log of x1 cross x2 and so on xn, we can write it as log of x1 plus log of x2 and so on log of xn. So if we have two numbers 2 and 3, so log of 2 cross 3 . This can be simplified to log of 2 and then log of 3. So it means log of product of these two numbers can be written as the sum of logs of these numbers, log 2 plus log 3. So here we have x1 to xn. So we can write it as log x1 and then log x2 and so on up to log xn. So this is sum of logarithm of n numbers x1 to xn. And in the last step, we can write this sum using the summation form. So log x1, log x2 and log xn, all these terms are being added. So for addition, we can use the summation notation. So summation log xi, where I ranges from 1 to n. So in next step, since we are interested in finding only x bar g, which is the geometric mean, so it means we have to shift this log to the right hand side. So this can be done by taking nt log on both sides. So if we take nt log here and nt log here, so this nt log and log, they will be cancelled. So we will be left with only x bar g, and on right hand side we will have nt log of this whole result. So this is called an alternative form of the same formula which is written here. So if we have small numbers, for example 5 numbers or 2, 3, 4 numbers, we can use this simple formula. But if we have more numbers, then we can use this formula in order to make our calculation more convenient. So we can use any of these two formulas. Formulas both will give the same results. So here are the two formulas. So we can use either this one or this formula in log and nt log form. Let us consider an example for finding geometric mean for the ungrouped data. So here we have marks obtained by 3 students, 2, 8 and 4, and we are interested in finding the geometric mean. So geometric mean can be calculated by using this formula x bar g, and since in this case we have only 3 numbers, so x1 cross x2 cross x3, so multiply 3 numbers x1, 2, 3 and take their cube root. So here first number 2, 8 and 4, so just multiply these 3 numbers, take their cube root. So 2 into 8 16, into 4 64, take the cube root. So we can calculate this cube root using Microsoft Excel or using calculator, or here we can solve it using simple arithmetic as well. So note that this 64, it can be written as 4 raised to power 3. So 4 into 4 into 4, 4 4 16, 16 4 64, so 4 raised to power 3, and then this cube root as it is, then 4 raised to power 3, and then writing this cube root as 1 4 raised to power 3 whole power 1 by 3. So we can cancel this 3 with 3, we are left with 4 raised to power 1, which is 4. So this is how to calculate geometric mean in case of ungrouped data using the simple formula. Now let us solve the same question using alternative method. So here again we have marks of the 3 students, 2, 8, 4, but now this time we are finding geometric mean using the alternative method. And remember that the geometric mean using the alternative method is nt log of 1 over n summation log xi. So let us denote these 3 marks by x, so 2, 8 and 4, and then look at this formula. In this formula we have to take log of x, or it means log of each number. So construct a new column labeled as log x, and then calculate log of each number. Log of 2, it is 0.30103. You can calculate this log using Microsoft Excel, or you can also calculate using the calculator. Similarly, calculate log of 8 and log of 4. So here is the log x, and next, according to this formula, we need to take sum of log xi. It means we need to add all the entries of this column. So here is summation log xi. So sum of all these 3 numbers, it is 1.80618. So replace this 1.80618 here in this formula. So you can see that summation log xi is 1.8 and 1 over n is 1 by 3, because in our case we have 3 observations. So this is 3 students. So just divide this number by 3 and then take the nt log. So we get 0.60 divide 1.80618 divided by 3, and here we have the 3 students. So the result is 1.825876. So this is how to calculate geometric mean for the ungrouped data. So let us review the main concepts which we have discussed in this lecture. So in this lecture we discussed how to calculate median for the grouped data and the merits and demerits of using median as a measure of central tendency. Then we discussed another measure of central tendency, which is mode, and we discussed method of finding mode for the ungrouped data as well as for the grouped data, and we discussed the merits and demerits of using mode as a measure of central tendency. And then we have also discussed the geometric mean and how to calculate geometric mean for the ungrouped data. In the next lecture we will discuss geometric mean and in particular we will discuss how to calculate geometric mean for grouped data. We will also review how to calculate geometric mean for the ungrouped data, which we have discussed in this lecture, in order to make consistency. And then we will also discuss some of the merits and demerits of using geometric mean as a measure of central tendency. And then we will discuss the last commonly used measure of central tendency, which is the harmonic mean. So we will discuss how to calculate harmonic mean for the grouped as well as for the ungrouped data. We will also discuss some of the merits and demerits of using harmonic mean as a measure of central tendency. So till then, Allah Hafiz.